A warm good morning all of you. This is Dr. Anil Kumar R. We'll be teaching you about the design of steel structural elements, which is prescribed from the VTU. And this is a VTU e-learning platform. From this platform, I will be teaching you the second module of your syllabus, that is bolted connections and welded connections. My dear friends, before going to the bolted or welded connection, a small introduction about these steel structures. See, we have various types of the materials such as plastic, aluminium, reinforced cement, concrete, steel, etc. are used to construct these structures. All around the world, it is common. The structural members generally may be analyzed by using the forces, which may be axial force or eccentric force, shear force, bending moment, torsion, etc., which depends upon the nature of these forces. Depending upon this, the type of materials will be used for the construction. Any good structures depend upon the following quality from the materials used in for its construction. One is its adequate strength, stability, rigidity, durability, functional requirements, economy, easy to handle, adaptation for the future requirements, and the expansion. That is the main criteria. Okay, in that, the predominantly we will use the steel. Why steel? Steel is the most ductile material which can be used for the construction. That is a major point. And second thing is, steel can be obtained by adding required quantity of the carbon to the iron. We all know that by processing. Now, generally, the factors like carbon content, your heat treatment processes, and element influences, the product influences, these all physical properties will give the much strength or more strength, elasticity, ductility, and toughness. They are the very good parameters. Hence, in our construction field, we give the most priority to the steel and steel elements. Some of the steel elements are carbon contented, and we know that IS standard sections, which are been used in the construction of building, bridges, are all the for the structural elements. Wherever for the carbon content, if it is more, then the mild steel will be produced within 0.1%. Okay. Then when you come to talk about the mechanical properties of steel, we all know it has the ultimate strength and tensile strength. Both strengths are been more compared to any other material. Then next thing is yield stress is good and proof stress is also very good. Then it is an enormously ductile material. It can be welded. It is having good toughness. It is resistant to corrosion. Only one thing is, we have to periodically maintain it by painting. Okay, then there are enormous number of types of structural steel available in the market. Carbon steel is there, high strength carbon steel is there, medium and high strength micro alloy steel is there, high strength quenched and temperate steel is there, weathering steel is there, stainless steel, fire resistant steels are available. So what is the major advantage, or what is the major merit of using the steel structure? Number one, whenever you want to high strength in compression and tension, you can go for the steel. Then next, self-weight is comparatively less to compare to concrete. Okay, then next, strength to weight ratio is 3.5 times to the that of the concrete. And I told you it is very high ductile, which can withstand the high deformation, and automatically structure can yield lowly at the point of high stress concentration, preventing the premature failure. And uniformity of the section is very good. Superior quality of construction can be brought up by using the steel. Okay, then it is environmental friendly. Since it is recyclable material, we all know that it is in very corrosive atmosphere. If it is not in a very corrosive atmosphere, it is eco-friendly or environmental friendly. It can be prefabricated. Then further expansion is very good. Then next, least disturbance. See, minimum disturbance to traffic and community, and hence it can be having a good financial loss, not a big financial loss will be there. Then fracture toughness is it, because these materials are capable of taking the high deformation. So during the fabrication and decoration, without any fracture, it can be welded or bolted. Then fantastic important advantage is, it is elastic material. The behavior of the steel is close to the design of the design assumptions and reserve strength is used in the plastic design. So there are some limitations, or we can say it is a disadvantage. Whenever you go for the large number of stresses reversal and variation in tensile stresses, the strength of member is reduced drastically. Very rare. Then steel structures are suspended to corrosion. That is the biggest task. Only one thing is you have to maintain it periodically. So hence automatically the cost of the steel structures will be more. It is cost of fireproofing also will be little higher to compare to that of the concrete. Then major thing is buckling of the member is more when you go for the long columns and slenderness ratio members, therefore column should be stiffened. That is the one thing. The last thing is we cannot go for the, as a designer, I cannot take whichever section I want. What are the sections which are available in the market, such section to be adopted while using the designs. Okay, with a small introduction of the steel structures, I will be going for carrying out for the bolted and welded connection. Before to do all the steel structures, I require the connections or connectors. So I can classify this connections. Based on four types. One is based on the type of the resultant force transferred through the connections. So what are those? First one is concentric connections. Here tension and compression members both will be there. Then second thing is eccentric connections. Bracket connections, beam to beam, beam to column, they all come under this condition. Then next second one is based on the type of the force in the connections. So for what are there? First one is shear connections, tension connections, combined shear and tension connections. The next one is based on the type of the fastening. What are these fastening? They are nothing but the fasteners or the connectors. See, from the predominantly whenever you want to connect two members, these are three members fasteners we majorly take place. One is rivets, second one is pins and bolts, third one is welds. Rivets are nowadays outdated. See, best example for rivets is if you take a nail and start hammering, okay, it is nothing but a riveting. Okay, that is rivets. Nowadays it has been older because whenever you hammer any kind of material, automatically there is a chance of rupture of the wall or a plate. Okay, so generally they will avoid riveting nowadays. So majority of go for welding or bolting. Then next is based on the joint resistance. It is simple, rigid and semi-rigid. Another one classification is there, which is based on the free transfer mechanism in the bolted connections. That is bearing type and friction type, which will be further discussed. Next, coming to this, what is a bolt? See, we wanted to have the connections of the bolted, so we should talk about the what is a bolt. See, the picture what you are seeing in the presentation itself, it is a typical example of the bolt. Look at the bolt there. It is nothing but a metal pin with a head at one end and shank threaded at the other in order to receive a nut, which is shown in the figure. See, generally whenever you do any kind of the bolting, they will go for the steel washers. I think we all seen in our residence, correct? Whenever they do bolting, they will place one washer below the head, one washer above the nut before netting. Why? Because it will serve the two purposes. One is to distribute the clamping pressure on the bolted members. Second thing is to prevent the threaded portion of the bolt from bearing on the connected plates. Look at, my dear friends, we can see the bolt. A typical bolt has been given here. This is the head part. This is the head part, and this is part is known as tail. The tail consists of two things. One is shank, the other one is thread. Okay, in this thread we have the nut also, and the length measured from tail, the end of the bolt, to the groove, the last groove, it is known as thread length. The second one, where the empty space where threading is not been provided, it is known as grip length. Total is known as nominal length. Okay, why shank is required? Why net is required? See, we can see one more bolt here, which is without any shank is there. Okay, if you want to have a smooth without any kind of friction, rubbing is there, you can go for the shank. If you don't want this, directly you can go for the thread. Generally, how can they reduce this? See, generally, whenever you want to use any kind of bolt or nut, we should know what is the part, how much part of thread is there, how much part of shank is being there. Generally, what they suggest is, whenever you want to design any kind of bolt, or required number of bolt, you should study what is a thread or what is a shank. So generally, whenever they go for thread, there will be 0.78% of only the shank part will be taken place. Otherwise, if you take shank, it is 100%. If you take thread, it is 78%. Okay, 0.78% to be applied. I'll tell you when you're doing the solving the problems, I'll teach you how to do this. Okay, this is a typical bolt. Next, these bolts are again been classified depending upon the, based on the load transformation in the connections. First one, it is known as unfinished bolts or black bolts or C grade bolts. Second one, it is turn bolts or precision bolts, or it is known as A grade bolts. Second one, another classification, it is B grade bolts, which are known as also semi precision bolts. Third classification is ribbed bolts, and finally it is high strength bolt. Now we'll start going on exploring about the what are the these bolts. Starting from the unfinished bolts or black bolts, see, look at this figure. This is a typical example which I have shown in the presentation. This is an unfinished bolts or nothing but black bolts which are available in the present market. Okay, these generally they are designated as the bolts from M5 to M36. Okay, in steel works, the usual size are of M15, M20, M24 and M30. Generally, unfinished bolts are also called as ordinary or common or rough or black bolts. They are used light for the light structures, means which are for the, we are presenting for the only static load. Is what are this? Purlins, bracing, etc. They are all come for the unfinished bolts only. Okay, only for the, used to be used for the only for the static load conditions. They are not for the recommend for the connections which are subjected to impact loads, means sudden loads, if they cannot be used. Then vibrations, fatigue, such conditions, we are not, it is not recommended to use the unfinished bolts. Okay, bolts are forged from the low carbon steel circular rods, permitting the large tolerance. Ordinary structural bolts are made up of the mild steel with the square or hexagonal heads will be available in the market. Okay, there are property class. If you refer IS 800, we can see property class. When in examination they will give the question, using black bolt design, or find or determine the bolt value of an black bolt of M20 grade with the property class 43.6 or 4.6. So what does this 4.6, 3.6, 4.8, 5.6, which are written in the presentation? Look at there, 4.6. If I take a specific example of 4.6, it is nothing but 1/100th of the nominal ultimate tensile strength in the MPa, nothing but the Newton per mm square. So it is an 4 indicates your nominal ultimate tensile strength in the MPa. It is nothing but 1/100, means it is 400. Then next, 0.6, it is nothing but the 6 ratio of yield stress to ultimate stress, which is in the percentage. So sir, how can we calculate this 4.6? It is, see, we are already having the ultimate tensile strength. Now using the ultimate tensile strength, I will be calculating the ultimate yield strength. How to calculate this yield strength? Look at this, 400 FU is 400 MPa of the bolt. Then yield stress will be, yield strength will be is equal to 0.6, the ratio into, ratio of yield stress into nominal ultimate tensile strength of the bolt. So it is, Fy will be is equal to 0.6 into FU, which is equal to 0.6 into 400, it is 240 MPa. Got it? So if it is given 5.6, FU will be 500, FY will be 0.6 into, depending upon the ultimate strength, and calculate. You can calculate. If you cannot calculate this corrections, if you refer IS 800 table number 1, which is given in page number 13 and page number 14 of IS 800 2007, directly the values are been directly shared in the IS code. We can directly taken from the values of ultimate stress and ultimate yield stress there. Okay, directly you can calculate or directly you can take from your IS 800. I will be showing you how to use IS 800 in the further classes. Okay, next, clearance hole diameter. Whenever you want to do bolt, I should do bolt hole also. But if I have M20 grade bolt, the dia of the bolt is already 20 mm, then how much should be the clearance or how much should be the bolt hole? So the code provision says, if I want to use the unfinished bolts or black bolt, you have to provide the bolt hole such a way that the dia of the bolt plus 1.5 to 2 mm allowance should be given. So what does indicate? If I take an example of M20 grade bolt, so dia of bolt is 20 mm plus 1.5, or sorry, you cannot round off, it to 2 mm. So 120 plus 2, how much it is? 22. So dia of the bolt is 20, the dia of bolt hole is 22. Okay, this is a typical example for the unfinished black bolts or C grade bolts. Next comes to the turn bolts or the finished bolts. See, IS 2591 in 1969 recommends about the turn bolt or the unfinished bolts. See, which are almost similar to that of the same old unfinished bolt. Turn bolts or finished bolts will be similar to that of the unfinished bolts only, which are made from the hexagonal rods. Okay, the difference of the shank of these four bolts will be found from the hexagonal rods only. The surface of the bolts are prepared carefully and are machined to fit into the hole. Tolerance allowance is very small, but these bolts are having the high shear and the bearing resistance as compared to the unfinished bolts. Okay, however, nowadays these bolts are absolutely not available in the market. Okay, so this is a typical example of the turned bolts or the finished bolts. Okay, next comes the ribbed bolts. So these ribbed bolts are called as flooded bolts, where the head of the bolts is almost compared to the rivet only. If you see that, almost it is like a rivet bolt only. Okay, the threaded and netted are provided on the one other end of the shank. From the shank core, longitudinal ribs project, making the diameter of the shank more the diameter of the hole. These ribs cuts groove into the connecting members while tightening and ensure the tight fit. These bolts have more resistance to vibration compared to that of the ordinary bolts. Okay, this is the typical ribbed bolt which you can see in the presentation. Okay, got it. Next comes to the very important bolt, that is high strength bolts. What is this high strength bolt? The name itself strength, it is an having bearing of high strength, or in other words, this is also known as high friction grip bolts or friction grip bolts. So what are these friction grip bolts? It is very important to know about the friction grip bolts. So what are they so important in the friction grip bolts? Generally, see, these are also made up of the bars of the medium carbon steel, that is no same similar that of the same old thing, but their highest strength is achieved through the quenching and tempering forces, or by alloying the steel. Okay, steel washers will be provided. Look at this. Steel washers will be provided of the hard steel or galvanized steel will be provided to evenly distribute the clamping pressure of the bolted member, which I discussed in the first starting of the slide. Majorly so only we will be using for the washers here. Okay, whenever if the bolts are tightened on the turned of the net method, the net is made slung and tightened off turn more than the hand warning, and these washers are not required. The vibrations and impact resistance of the joint is also improved by using the high strength friction grip bolts. Okay, the majorly IS 3751 1972 have the recommendations, along with the IS 4000 1967 have the recommendation of the high strength friction grip bolts. See, these things have been already, what these bolts both are been replaced of this value. These people, many of them people are been using these bolts by replacing the rivets which are in the structure, because such a whenever we already we are moving in a high rise buildings, okay, bridges, machines, there they are already using the high strength bolts to avoid the slip resistance, to get the slip resistance. Okay, main thing is this HSB bolts transformation from one component to other component takes place by the friction. These bolts have a high strength several times that of the ordinary bolts. High strength bolts have been replaced rivets and been used in the structure such as high rise buildings and bridges. Due to the friction, there is no slip in joint. Hence, the connection with the high strength bolts are called as friction type or non-slip connections. The initial tension in the bolt is known as proof load. The initial tension in the bolt is known as proof load of the bolt, and the coefficient of friction is known as the slip factor. Okay, so how to calculate proof load in this? It is simple, that 0.8 times of area of root diameter into proof stress. So how to calculate, sir, percentage elongation? It is 12%. You can calculate also, but generally high strength bolts will be having the 12% elongation. Coming to next, we'll worry about the what are the advantages, why should I use the high strength bolts. Number one thing is, see, whenever you go for the high strength bolts, automatically we should worry about the advantages. Means so many are telling about the high strength bolt, means I should know the merits of using this high strength friction grip bolts. So first thing, no slip will be of the elements will be connected. Second thing is, lot tensile stresses are been developed in the bolts. Third thing is, bolts are not subjected to shear and bearing. Third one is, frictional resistance is effective outside the bolt hole and load transmission through the net sections only. And next thing is, no stresses concentration in the holes. Fatigue strength is much more than compared to the rivet bolts or the ordinary bolts. And major thing is, noise nonsense is not at all there, because we have the washers in between. Then alterations can be done very easily. See, main thing is, whenever you want to replace any kind of bolts, if you cannot be able to replace it, it is waste. Okay, for further expansion and all, if you want to remove the bolt and put the bolt, it should be very difficult, correct? By using this HSB bolt, I can do the alteration work very easily. Now we'll study about the friction mechanism of this bolted connections. It is to be known by any kind of, before using this bearing connection or the friction connection, I should know about what is the, how can the force transmit in the member. Okay, look at this figure, bearing connections. It is the free body diagram of the shear force transferring in the bearing type of the bolted connection. It is seen that tension in one plate is equilibrated by the bearing stresses between the bolt and the hole in the plate. Since there is an clearance between the bolt and the hole in which is fitted, the bearing stresses is mobilized only after the plate slips related to the one another and start bearing on the bolt. Okay, if I take a section XX in the bolt, which is critical section of the shear, automatically I can see this bearing stresses. Okay, since this is a lap joint, means placing on one another, I'll tell you about the lap joint later, only one critical section of the shear. Okay, if this plate moves along this direction and this plate moves along this direction, I can see single shear failure in the bolt. Okay, in such cases, automatically I can see one failure only. Whereas if I take the butt, means two shear failures, there would be two critical sections, nothing but the double shear failure may takes place. Okay, when it comes to the high strength friction grip bolts, the free body is shown here. Look at this. Okay, here it can be seen that the pre-tensioning in the bolt causes the clamping forces between the plate even before the external load is applied. Okay, then whenever the external load is applied, the tendency of two plates to slip against the one another is resisted by the what? Friction between the plates. The frictional resistance is equal to the coefficient of friction multiplied by the normal clamping force between the plates. Until an external applied force exceeds the frictional resistance, the relative slip between the plates is prevented. The HSFC bolts connections are designed such that under service load, force does not exceed the frictional resistance, so that relative slip is avoided during the service. Okay, whenever you use the HSFC bolt, very important thing here is when the external force exceeds the frictional resistance, the plate slips until the bolts come into the contact with the plate and start bearing the against the hole. Beyond this point, the external force is resisted by the combined action of the frictional resistance along with the bearing resistance. This is the beauty of the frictional connection. You can see the frictional force, how can it has been plated. Okay, so this is the clamping force, the yellow color. One more is pink color, you can see here. Okay, I am separating the figure now, which has been separated due to the tension. Whenever the external force is compression, internally tension will be created. Whenever the tension force exerts, internally compression, because it is a resistance force. We all know stress is what? Nothing but the resistance, correct? So force per unit area, should remember the strength of materials. Okay, moving to this, we should know how does this transfer of the tension will be taking place and what is this prying effect. Okay, look at this figure. This is then free body diagram of the tension transfer in the bearing type of the bolted connection. This one connection, the variation of the bolt tension due to the externally applied tension has been shown here. Look at the graph. Okay, it is in seen that before any external tension is applied, the force in bolt is almost zero, correct? Since the bolts are only slung tight, an external tension is increased, it is equilibrated by the increasing the bolt tension. Failure is reached due to the large elongation when the root of the bolt start yielding. Depending on the relative flexibility of the plate and bolt, sometime the opening of the joint may be accompanied by the prying action. See, look at this. This is known as prying action, because it is the prying action points. Okay. Whereas if you come to the HSFC bolts, it is the free body diagram of HSFC bolt. Look at this. Even before any external load is applied, the force in the bolt is equal to the proof load. Correspondingly, there is a clamping force between the plates in contact. Okay, when external load is applied, partly, I think nearby 10% of the load is equilibrated by the increase in the bolt force. The balance of the force is equilibrated by reduction in the contact between the plates. This process continues and contact between the plates is maintained until the contact force due to the pre-tensioning is done, which is reduced to zero by adding the by external applied load. Normally, design is done such a way that externally applied tension does not exceed the level. After the external force exceeds this level, the behavior of bolt under tension is essentially same as that of the bearing type bolt. Means if the bolt, HSFC bolts fails, or if it slips automatically, it will not fail properly directly. It will, once it becomes, if the tightening is more automatically, if it has got, it will not fail. It will behave first, it will start try to behave as an ordinary bolts only. That is the main advantage of your HSFC connections. Okay, this is about the bolts which are under the tension. So this prying effect is very important for us. And look at the graph here. Whenever you draw a graph, applied load, this is proof load. If I draw this for the bolt force automatically, this is bearing type, whereas this initially it will not take anything, automatically it will rise and then reach the bearing type. This is the common point. So HSFC bolts are very predominant to take the tension and shear bolt compared to that of the rib bolt turned finished or ordinary black bolt. Generally in market, present market, we can able to get a majorly the buildings will be having HFC bolts or unfinished or black bolts. Generally for heavy load structures, they'll go for HSFC bolts. For normal building, normal load structures, for which are static under condition, they will go for the unfinished bolts or C-grade bolts. Okay, next, going for the next, we should go for the joints. What are these joints? See, there are generally in steel structures, we are having two types of connections. One is lap joint, one is butt joint. This is lap joint or lap connection. This is butt joint. Okay, I am showing you single lap joint, whereas this is single butt joint and this is double butt joint. Look at this, a single lap joint, one member is placed on the other member, and what you can see, the your lines are nothing but the bolt, placing of the bolt, so that it should not move. Okay, so this will occur, which will induce, whenever the force in tension creates, it will increase the single shear failure. Very, very rarely you can see the double shear failure here. Whereas here in the butt joint, two plates are placed similarly on the plane. On this plane, one more cover plate will be placed. Through this, bolts will be there, such that we will be having a much more efficiency of the member. This is single cover plate, whereas this, it is double cover plate, which is very important connections, which take the much more higher loads than the normal connections. Okay, generally in the lap joint, the minimum lap should be less than that of the 4 times of the thickness of the thinner plate part joint for the how many number of bolts. Generally what they say is 40, should be less than 40 mm. Okay, whichever is least you should take. Whereas in this butt joint, the joint place to be connected against the each other, and the connection is made by providing the cover plates. Look at this, this is known as cover plates, are one on one or on the both sides of the joint. If the cover plate is provided on the one side, is called single cover butt joint. If the cover plate is provided on the both sides, it is known as double cover butt joint. Okay, these are the two joints which are to be always analyzed. Okay, now. So these are the about the connections. So what next? We know the connections, we have learned about the connections, but before starting any designs, I was telling you we are doing the bolted part. So bolt holes place the very predominant bolts. So as per our IS 800, there are some recommendations or guidelines to be followed while doing the bolt holes. First one, usually go for the drilled one, not punched one. Okay, drilling will be usually done so that rupture of the plate can be avoided, or rupture of the member can be avoided. Then the IS code allows you the punched holes only in the materials whose yield strength, nothing but the FI, does not exceed 360 MPa, and where thickness does not exceed the 5600 by yield stress, which is in the mm. That is very important, which is highlighted here. Okay, then bolts holes are made larger than the bolt diameter to facilitate the erection. See, whenever you put the bolt, your bolting should not disturb the plate or the member. So little bit higher or larger should be made. Then oversized holes should not exceed 1.25 times of the dia of the bolt, or in other words, you can take D plus 8 mm in diameter, where D is the nominal bolt diameter in the mm. So oversized bolt hole should not be exceeding 1.25 times of the diameter. This is very important. Next thing is slotted holes, which means which are provided to accommodate the movements, should not exceed 1.33 times of the dia of the bolt in the length. for the short slotted hole. If it is for the long slotted hole, it is 2.5 times the die of the bolt. Okay, next. See, look at this figure. This is the plan or the top view of the bolt plate. See, look here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bolts holes are there. Okay. The distance measured from center of the bolt hole to the one more bolt hole, it is known as pitch. And the distance measured from the last bolt or the first bolt, if you take from this side, it is first bolt, the center of the bolt to the last part, it is known as edge distance. Okay, the distance measured from the top to the bottom, see, it is vertical, whereas if you take measuring from the horizontal, it is pitch. Vertical, it is known as gauge length. Got it? So edge distance, pitch, gauge is very important. The edge distance should be sufficient bearing for the bearing capacity and should be provide space for the bolt head, washer and the nut. So minimum the spacing of how much? 2.5 times the nominal diameter of the fasteners is specified in the code to ensure that there is a sufficient space to tighten the bolts, to prevent the overlapping of the washers and to provide the adequate resistance to the tear out of the bolts. Okay. Next thing is, we should discuss about the failures of the shear connections. This is very important to when we, before starting any design, we should know what is the type of the failure, where the bolt will fail, what is the bolt value, how many number of bolt holes, how many number of bolts to be provided, and what is the efficiency of the joint. That thing you should do. To do this, so we should worry about the failure of the bolted joints. Generally, the bolted joint may be fast any of the following size, ripping out from which is some failure can be checked out. Adequacy of the specification of the edge distance, therefore, there are not much important. Therefore, whereas other requirement to be considered, one is what? Shearing, shear failure of the bolt. The shear stress in the bolt may exceed the working shear stress in the bolt. Okay, so this is the shearing of the bolt. I showed you in the lap joint. Generally, the shear stresses are generated because of the plate slips due to the applied force. If this force tends to move from the away and this from this force, this plate, automatically there will be a cut of the bolt or nothing but the shear. Okay, this is known as shearing of the bolt. One more thing is bearing failure of the plate. Might your bolt may sustain, but plate may fail. Are you getting here? This is the bearing plate failure. Sometime due to the combined effect of tension and shear, the bearing failure of the bolt may take place and it may split up or it may break. Bolt may fail. Generally, this happens in the butt joint. So, how to overcome this? Our IS 800 recommends the following formulas which has to be calculated, which can for the bolt value. So, if we want to calculate shear capacity of the bolts, VDSB is equal to mu F into divided by root 3 into NNANB plus NSASB in divided by whole thing divided by gamma MB. The second thing is bearing capacity of the bolts, VSB is equal to 2.5 times of D into K T into FU divided by root gamma MB. It is actually K is missing here. Gamma MB. Then tension capacity of the bolts, TB is equal to 0.9 times of FUB AN divided by gamma MB, which is lesser than the FUB ASB into gamma M gamma ML plus divided by gamma M0 whole thing divided by gamma MB. If it is subjected to both combined and shear tension, shear and tension, it is V divided by VSD squared plus T divided by TDN whole square, which should be lesser or equal to the 1. Sir, we need to by hat. No, you need not to do any kind of by hatting of these formulas. Where it is available? It is available in the IS 800. Let me open the IS 800 from the net. See this code. It is freely available. You can get the PDF format of this code. Get a printout of this. While solving the problems, IS 800-2007, if you provide the free download, you can easily have it. See, this is an IS 800-2007 code. It is a general construction in the steel code for practice. If you move here, there is a content. Just have a glance of this. I will tell you the important page numbers here, which you have to know about this. These are the terminologies in our steel structures. So you need not to worry. Look at this. A, what is this? A, K of cross section, AC, area of the root of the truss. Then again, AN, net area of the total cross section, ANF, net area of the area in the flange. Okay, abbreviations have been given here. For us, main thing is go to page number 13. What for? It is the tensile property of the structural steel. See, we discussed about unfinished black poles 4.6 class. Look at here, 4.6 here, grade is being given 4.6. So yield stress you should calculate. So how much it is? 240. So ultimate tensile strength is 400. Above 6.8, it is 600. You can calculate this value. If it is 8.8 only, look at this, 8.8. See, look at this, 8.8. If the diameter of the bolt is lesser than the 6 or equal to 16 mm, then yield stress is 640, ultimate tensile strength is 800. If your 8.8 grade D, die of the bolt, is greater than 16, then the yield stress is 660, whereas your ultimate tensile strength is 830. Got it? This is in page number 13 and continuation is in 14. Okay, I will teach you when you are solving the problems. Then comes T. We'll go to the filler section where it is in page number 72, 73. So page number 72, 75, I think so. I'll discuss all these things, what and all is there for an IS 800, which are important for you. We have to, whenever you are free, kindly go through these books, because it is very important. Being an engineer, should know about all those things. Just have a glance, should be very important for you. So look at the page number 75. Look at this. Page number 75 of IS 800. Now, the shear capacity of the bolt. Make it a bigger. The shear capacity of the bolt, the design shear strength, or shear strength of the bolt, VDSB, design shear strength of the bolt, VDSB, has governed the shear strength, which is given by VDSB is equal to VNSB divided by gamma MB, where VNSB is nothing but the nominal shear capacity of the bolt, which has been calculated by VNSB is equal to FU divided by root 3 into NNANB plus NSASB, where what is this FU? It is the ultimate tensile strength of the bolt. Okay, the second one, NN, number of the shear planes with the threads intercepting the shear plane. NS, number of shear planes without threads intercepting the shear plane. Means it is, NS is nothing but the number of n is the shear planes without the threads intercepting the shear planes. So ASP is the nominal plane shank area, whereas A and B is the net area of the bolt at the threads, may be taken as the area of the corresponding to the root diameter. Okay, whenever it is given the length of the joint or splice or end connection in the compression or tension element containing more than two bolts, then it should not exceed the 15 into die of the bolt or in the direction of the load. So how to calculate this correction? The correction factor B beta ij is equal to 1.075 times minus lj divided by 200 times of d, but 0.75 times lesser than or equal to bij, it should be lesser than or equal to 1. So what the current is concerned is 1.07 minus 0.005 times of lj by d. This is the correction factor. If you are going for the packing plate, so for the packing plate beta pk is equal to 1 minus 0.012 times of the thickness of the packing plate to be taken care. When doing solving the problem, I will teach you how to calculate the packing plate thickness, how to do this correction for the shear strength of the capacity. Okay, next coming to the bearing capacity. Okay, so bearing capacity is equal to look here, the design bearing strength of the bolt on any plate VDPB as governed by the bearing is given by VDPB. See, there is, it is VDSP, it is VDPB. See, VDSB, it is of the bolt, whereas this is for the plate VDPB. So VNPB divided by gamma MB, where VNPB, see, bearing takes place in the bolt also, plate also, but bearing capacity is to be calculated for the bolt with reference to the plate only. Okay, VNPB is equal to nominal bearing strength of the bolt, which is equal to 2.5 times of KB into D into T into FU, where KB is the smaller of the E divided by 3D naught or P divided by 3D naught minus 0.25, or FUB by FU, or it should be 1. FUB is nothing but the ultimate tensile strength of the bolt. FU is nothing but the ultimate strength of the plate. Okay. E, it is an edge distance or end distance. P is the pitch distance. I will teach you how to calculate edge distance and the pitch distance. Okay. Then D naught or DH, both will be used. D naught or DH, nothing but the die of the bolt hole. D is the diameter of the bolt, T is the thickness of the plate. Generally, should take the thickness of the plate, which is least thickness should be considered. Okay. Then, coming to the tension capacity. If you move to the page number 32 and 33, here design strength due to yielding of the grossing, TDG is equal to AGF0 FI divided by gamma M0. This is yielding gross strength. If it is go for the critical rupture to the critical section for the plates, it is TDN is equal to 0.9 types of AN into FU divided by gamma ML. It is in page number 32. AN depends upon the, if it is in straggled normal chain bolting or straggered bolting or zigzag bolting is there, if the formulas will be changing. I will teach you in the problems. Okay, then if it is for the single angles, it is TDN is equal to 0.9 times of ANC into FU divided by gamma ML plus beta into AG0 FI divided by gamma M0. Again, the bolts will be subjected to the block shear, failure may be predominant. So how to calculate this? It is given in page number 33 only. Look at this. TDB is equal to AVG FY divided by root 3 gamma M naught plus 0.9 times of ATN FU divided by gamma ML, or TDB is equal to 0.9 times of AVN FU divided by root 3 gamma ML plus ATG FY divided by gamma M naught. This block shear failure, while doing the tension members, they will be teaching you about the block shear failure. Okay, but for this time being, you should be knowing about the shear capacity and bearing capacity of the bolt, which is given in the page number 75. Okay, then next, continuing our PPT, when it comes to friction grip bolts, what to do? The same old quotes suggest in page number 76, page number 76 tells you about the friction grip bolts. Look at this, tension capacity also given here only, TDB lesser than or equal to TDB 0.9 FUB AN, it should be less than FUB FIB ASB into gamma MB divided by gamma M naught. Okay, so if it is combined shear and tension, which I discussed in the presentation, this is the formula. Where coming to friction grip bolts, wherever you want to calculate slip resistance, the formula is given by VD SF. It should be lesser than equal to VSF. So VDSF, how is it calculated? VNSF divided by gamma MF, where VNSF is equal to mu F into NE into KH into F naught. What is this mu F? Is nothing but the coefficient of friction, or nothing but the slip factor, which is given in table number 20. Here only it is there in table number 20 of page number 77. See, it is surface not treated, 0.2. Surface blasted with short R grit with any loss rust removed, not pitting, it is 0.5. Generally, what we say take is sand blasted surface after light rusting, 0.52. If they are not mentioned, you can take it this value as 0.52. Then NE, number of effective interfaces of offering frictional resistance to slip. Then KH, one for the fastener in the clearance holes. So we're taking the fasteners in the clearance holes only. Oversize, if it is oversizes, it is 0.85. If it is for the fasteners in the longer slotted holes, loaded perpendicular, it is 0.85 only. If the fasteners is long slotted holes, load parallel to the slot, it is 0.7 to be taken. Then gamma MF is 1.1. It is for the slip resistance designed at the service load. If it is slip resistance at the ultimate load, it will take 1.25. Then F naught is the minimum bolt tension, nothing but the proof load. Installation may be taken, which has taken as ANB into F naught. ANB is nothing but the net area of the bolts at the thread. F naught is the proof stress, nothing but the 0.7 times of the FUB. Okay, we will be solving about this and along with the bolt values from the shear capacity and bearing capacity. For normal ordinary bolts, go for the page number 75, shear capacity of the bolts and bearing capacity of bolts. Compare these two values. Whichever is the value is least is considered as the bolt value. Whereas if it is a slip resistance bolt or HSFC bolt to be used, go for this formula, which is given in page number 76. Okay. At this stage, I'll be stopping this presentation. In the next class, we'll solve these problems about this, and we'll continue with the further module. Thank you.